Hallelujah, Lord, you are worthy. You are worthy. And this morning we come before you, Lord, to give you all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. Today we're celebrating Palm Sunday across the entire world. And we are indeed grateful for what our Lord has done for us. And this morning there is a word. There is a word from the Lord. And the word today is truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. So welcome one and all to Recharge Ministries. And again, today the word is, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. And our scripture is taken from Luke 23, 43 to 45. And it reads as thus, Jesus answered him, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon, for the sun stopped shining. Jesus answered him, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon, for the sun stopped shining. Let's pray. Father, I just want to thank you for this word, oh God, that you have deposited in my spirit today, Father. I pray, Lord God, that every ear that hears it, Lord God, they will say, I yield, I yield. I pray that today, Lord God, this word, Lord, will rest upon our hearts, Lord. And it will transform and renew us for your glory. Father, I pray right now that every ear that hears this word, Father, will be convicted of it, Lord God Almighty, as we are in the season of reflection, reflecting upon what you have done and the sacrifice that you have made just for us to redeem us back to the Father. I thank you, Lord God, for this impartation. And I pray that when it's all said and done, Lord God, this word will be powerful. It will be quick. It will be sharper than any two-edged sword, Lord God Almighty. And we will see the manifestation of your word. I give you thanks and I give you praise right now. Amen and amen. So I've been on a round of series speaking on the 7 last statements uttered by Jesus during the crucifixion as recorded in the Gospels. And today is no exception, because truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise is the 2nd statement spoken by Jesus while he was hung on the cross. So just for the benefit of others that don't know what the 7 last statements or words are uttered by Jesus during the crucifixion, they are as follows in this order. The first statement was, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Luke 23, verse 34. The second, which is today's message, is truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Luke 23, verse 43. The third is, woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. John 19, 26 through 27. The fourth is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Matthew 27, verse 46, Mark 15, verse 34. And we saw it also referenced in Psalms 22, verse 1. I thirst, John 19, verse 23. The sixth one, it is finished, John 19, verse 30. And seventh and last, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And that's Luke 23, verse 46. I have spoken on, Father, forgive them. Today is truly also my God, and I thirst. And all these recordings are on Facebook as well as on our YouTube channel for Recharge Ministry. So please go and listen to those awesome recordings that have been already done. So like I mentioned today, the utterance, the statement, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. It represents the second statement spoken by Jesus while he hung on the cross. So during Jesus' crucifixion, there were two other men crucified alongside Jesus, one on his left and the other on his right. The fact that Jesus was crucified on the middle cross is no accident. It's no accident that Jesus was crucified on the middle cross, as Jesus's position symbolizes his centrality in both history and eternity, effectively dividing them into two distinct parts. I want to reiterate that again. The fact that Jesus was crucified on the middle cross is no accident, as Jesus's position symbolizes his centrality in both history and eternity, effectively dividing them into two distinct parts. In the annals of history, time is demarcated into eras before Christ, represented as BC, and after Christ, which is AD, underscoring the transformative impact of Jesus's life. So likewise, Jesus serves as the definitive divider in eternity, as articulated in John 14, verse 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. In essence, Jesus emerges as the ultimate arbiter, dividing line for those who spend eternity with God or eternity separated from God. The conversion of the thief on the cross to Jesus's right reveals some fundamental truth. It underscores and emphasizes that salvation cannot be earned through human efforts or works, as the dying thief had no opportunity to perform deeds to earn acceptance from God. Instead, salvation is a gift of grace received through faith. And this incident serves as a powerful evidence that salvation is faith in God and not our own works. So no man can boast about our works, because it's faith and belief in God to result into our salvation and our redemption. So this incident also debunks and discredits the notion of universal salvation, as only one thief was saved through his personal faith in Jesus on that fateful day. And it further highlights the exclusivity of faith in Jesus as a sole pathway to redemption. I want to reiterate that. The incident on the cross with Jesus and the two thieves, it debunks the notion of universal salvation, as only one thief was saved through his personal faith in Jesus Christ on that fateful day. And it further highlights the exclusivity of faith in Jesus as a sole pathway to redemption. The first words or statements of Jesus from the cross were, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And some pundits have argued that this implies universal salvation for all through Jesus' sacrifice. All are saved through Jesus' sacrifice. However, Jesus specifically pledged eternal life in paradise to only one man who placed his faith in him. So no such assurance was given to anyone else present at the crucifixion, including the man on Jesus' left who lacked faith.
So during my sermon yesterday on March 3rd, where I preached on Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. It was Jesus' prayer wherein Jesus was asking the Father to hold back wrath till the people had time to believe. Jesus was asking the Father not to judge them till they had time to repent. So at the cross, Jesus was imploring them and us today to experience his mercy, to see his love, and to listen to his call to salvation. It is a postponement of judgment, which cannot be equated with elimination of judgment. So to receive forgiveness, you must accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And our Lord implores us to accept the gifts. Accept the gift of forgiveness and eternal life through his sacrifice at the cross. So Jesus' response to the dying criminal's plea for mercy, "Today you will be with me in paradise," is echoed in Luke 23, and it speaks to us about our heaven, our eternal home. The Greek word for paradise in this verse is a transliteration of a Persian word that was used in ancient times to refer to a king's garden that was a place of profound beauty, beautiful gardens, trees, and lush waters. So cast your imagination with me today and envision the king's garden. It's picturesque. It's almost surreal. And its beauty cannot be compared to anything we have experienced. It cannot be compared to anything or any place we have been. There is no comparison. What I found through this story is there was about three perspectives that day. Through this statement, "Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise," the reality was one man died in sin. So at the cross, one man died in sin due to his rebellion. For the man on the left of Jesus wasn't rescued without redemption. He wanted Jesus to rescue him without him believing in the rescuer. He wanted rescue without redemption from his sin. The second is one man receives salvation. So for the man on the right of Jesus, he places his personal faith in Jesus and receives salvation, escaping eternal damnation and suffering and receiving eternal liberation. So he received Jesus into his heart. He accepted Jesus into his heart. And as a result, he received salvation. The third is one man died for sin, redeeming mankind. Jesus bore the sin of the believing thief and the sins of all who would believe in him. He took on our tribulation by identifying with us. Jesus was bearing the sins of the murderers, the adulterers, the thief, the liars, and all of the sinful people, bearing the sins of the whole world and humanity. The one that knew no sin became sin for us. What a savior. What a savior. One man died in sin. One man received salvation, and one man died for sin. What a savior. Oh, what a savior. But there are two important elements surrounding the statement Jesus made, where he said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." And the importance of this is that there was the sinner's request and the Savior's response. Sinners, plural. The sinner's request and the Savior's response. So the first is the sinner's request. And there were two sinners on the cross, the one to the left and the one to the right of Jesus. And I'll talk about the one on the left first, because the one on the left, he had a very sad and short-sighted request. So the one on the left asked Jesus to save him from the agony of his suffering. And like I said, this is a sad and short-sighted, narrow-minded outlook that focused solely on immediate relief from torment. It wasn't the fact that he was sorrowful. He wanted immediate relief from his torment. And I kind of discerned or surmised or made an assumption about his life that it is evident that he pursued instant gratification, because he prioritized his fleeting desires without considering the eternal consequences. And he appeared to be swayed by the crowd's influence, conforming to their expectation. He's the kind that like to fit in. Don't we know so many of those that like to fit in? Because his words mirrored the crowd surrounding the cross, who challenged Jesus to prove his divinity by saving himself. As written in Matthew 27, verse 40. And Luke 23, verse 39, if you are the Christ, Son of God, save yourself, come down from the cross. So this thief simply echoed the sentiments he had heard from the crowd without any regard for the long-term consequences and significance of his actions. And observing the crowd's hostility towards Jesus, the thief on the cross perceived that aligning with the majority meant opposing Christ. And the prevailing sentiment among the crowd was to condemn Jesus. And this was evident by their cursing and spitting upon him. And this scenario parallels modern day behaviors. Like I said, this is like deja vu. That's how we behave today. Where individuals conform to popular opinion rather than making independent and unpopular choices. It's what's popular today. The way we dress, the way we look, the way we feel, everything, every decision point is wrapped around popular choices. And many are reluctant to stand alone and assert their individuality because we find more comfort to echo the sentiment of the majority. That's what this thief did that day. The thief on the left, he echoed what everybody else was doing, even though he wanted something from Jesus. He didn't see the errors in his ways. And in essence, Jesus was on the cross due to Pilate's failure to resist the pressure of public opinion. Here we go again. Despite recognizing Jesus' innocence, Pilate yielded to the demands of the masses. And scripture reveals that Pilate acted to appease the crowd, highlighting the power of collective influence. I say again, don't we know many of these today. It's the majority. It's the masses. It's the collective influences. So similar to the thief on the left, he merely echoed the words of the crowd, lacking any personal conviction. His actions exemplified the tendency to conform rather than exercise independent judgment. So the unbelieving thief had the same chance, the same opportunity for salvation as the one who put his trust in Christ and entered paradise. He lacked the courage and the faith to open his heart to trust Jesus. And I can dare to say that countless individuals remain separated from God because they prioritize the opinions of others over their own spiritual well-being. I pray to God that that's not you. Because we run with the crowd. Whatever the crowd say or do, it's what we run with. And countless individuals remain and will remain separated from God because they don't prioritize God, but they prioritize the opinions of others. And as a result, their own spiritual well-being is in jeopardy today. Then there was the saving request of one sinner. So the other sinner, the right of Jesus, in the beginning, he joined in with the one on the left. And in Matthew 27, verse 44, we read that the thieves mocked Jesus, because the second one seemed to be influenced by the thief on the left. And I kind of analyzed and I said, you know, it's possible that his association with the wrong crowd led him to the cross in the first place. Like I said, we all know somebody that fits the scenario that I'm depicting today. And throughout the thief's life, he might have fallen into those who led him astray. And now he found himself facing the end of his journey and this cruel fate that he was about to experience on the cross. But until, there's an until moment, and all of us kind of fall into this same scenario that we used to mess up. We used to do the wrong thing. But something happened. There's a moment in time that our lives changed. So something wonderfully happened to the thief on the right side of Jesus that day. Because after years of succumbing to peer pressure, he finally made a decision for himself. And he opened his heart to what he knew was right, rather than blindly following others. In that moment, faith was kindled within him, my God. And beside Jesus on the cross, he saw the Lord in a new light and believed in him as both Lord and Savior. So one can only imagine the turmoil experienced by the thief on Jesus's right. Leading up to the crucifixion the night before, I'm sure he struggled, he twisted, he turned all night, because his life was about to come to an end. This dreaded death was upon him. I'm sure he was wondering, where do I go after death? And as morning broke, he was led from his cell towards Golgotha, a place of execution. And as he made his way towards the place of death, he overheard the crowd yelling at this man called Jesus. And when the Lord went up to Calvary, women wept for Jesus, prompting the thief to probably wonder his own plight. And is there anyone there weeping for me, like they're weeping for this man called Jesus? Does anybody care for me? Because perhaps there was no family member that showed up that hour of death for him, and he was all alone to die. Yet amid his solitude, on the cross, in the middle was Jesus, the friend of sinners. On the cross, in the middle was Jesus, the friend of sinners. Then he heard Jesus' words to the weeping woman. Do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. And this stirred something within the thief on the right. I'm sure he said, what manner of man facing such a horrible death could show concern for others rather than himself? Because it was all man for themselves in that hour. And perhaps it was in this defining moment that the thief on the right began to perceive Jesus in a new light for the very first time. When Jesus was lifted up on the cross, the thief observed the Lord speaking the words. He didn't curse. He didn't revel. He didn't have disdain for the crucifers. But Jesus was silent. He was silent like a lamb before the slaughter. And instead, in that moment, the thief heard Jesus utter, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." This profound act of mercy and forgiveness could not have escaped the thief. And in that moment, a spark of faith ignited within him as he realized that Jesus was no ordinary man. Because witnessing Jesus' suffering, witnessing Jesus' response to suffering, the thief on the right spoke out. In that moment, witnessing Jesus' suffering, the thief spoke out. And in Luke 23, verse 40, he rebuked the other criminal, the other thief to the left, saying, "Don't you fear God, since you are under the same sentence." Don't you fear God, since you are under the same sentence. And this exchange was significant, indicating a newfound reverence for God within the thief's heart, the one on the right. No wonder Proverbs 9, 10 through 12 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. For through wisdom, your days will be many, and your years will be added to your life. If you are wise, your wisdom will reward you. If you are a mocker, you alone will suffer." So while the people mocked Jesus that day, the thief on the left cursed at Jesus. The thief on the right. The thief on the right experienced faith in the holiness of Jesus and the authority of God. The thief on the right experienced faith in the holiness of Jesus and the authority of God. And the thief on the right acknowledged the necessity of judgment. Because from the cross, he declared that both he and the thief on the left deserve their punishment. He admitted his own guilt and acknowledged the justice of their sentence. And in the same breath, he affirmed Jesus' innocence, recognizing that he had committed no crime deserving of death. And I conclude that understanding to say that truly, it's truly remarkable how faith in Christ can illuminate the truth in us and open up our heart to understand. When we accept God, there's an illumination of truth that comes alive in us. And it opens our heart to understanding God's word. I'm a living witness. When I truly dive into the word, my God, it illuminated me. There's an illumination that takes place. There's a pouring in that takes place. That when you have faith in God, it illuminates the truth in you and opens up your heart to understand. And that's what happened to the thief on the right. We are in need of a generation that earnestly cries out to God for mercy and seek his grace and his unmerited favor. We need a generation to cry out to God for mercy and to seek his grace and his unmerited favor. And for the temporal things that we desire, but to earnestly cry out to him. And it is evident that the thief on the right recognized justice inherent in God's judgment. And he acknowledged his own sinfulness and realized that he was receiving the consequences he deserved. And like the prodigal son who felt unworthy, and the repentant tax collector who beat his breast and cried, God be merciful to me, a sinner. This thief recognized his need for a savior. He recognized his need for a savior. Do you recognize the need for a savior in our life today? Do you recognize that you need Jesus? Because a thief on the right made his plea to Jesus. He said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. That was his earnest plea. And the plea was simple, but straight from the heart. Straight from the heart. There was no fanfare. There was no put it on. Simple words. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Simple, but straight from the heart. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. But I want you to take a look at three perspectives. There was a personal, there was a passionate, and a public nature to what the thief on the right did. The personal was the interaction between the thief on the right and Jesus. It was a deeply personal, unaffected by the presence or opinions of the crowd. There was a personal locking in. And it underscored the individual's responsibility each person has to their own salvation. There's an individual responsibility each person has for their own salvation. Each individual must personally seek salvation. It can't be when you're in the building, in the brick and mortar, in the four walls. There's a personal walk with God. There's a personal interaction. There's a communion that must take place. And when I said communion, it's not drinking the wine and the bread, eating the bread. Communion is interaction with God, is talking with God. It's locking in with God. It's sitting at his feet as he pours out into you. There was an interaction. There was a dialogue that was taking place in the midst of the crowd and all the noise. The thief and Jesus were deeply personal. And they weren't swayed about where they were. There was an individual responsibility that he locked in on. In seeking salvation. The second is a passionate nature. The thief's plea was heartfelt. It was heartfelt as he cried out, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember. There was a crying from the depth of his heart. Jesus. Jesus. And there's a comma there. So there was a pause. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. There was a request. And there was a response. Because immediately following, Jesus responded with assurance. I tell you the truth. Today, you will be with me in paradise. The third is the public nature. The thief boldly made his request and declaration of faith in front of all witnesses. This highlights the importance of openly expressing one faith. Your salvation cannot be a private affair. If you are ashamed of Jesus before others, Jesus will be ashamed of you. Faith must be openly and confidently professed, just as the thief did, without concern for public opinion. Does anybody know that you are a Christian? At your job, does anybody know? At school, does anybody know that you're a Christian? Because there must be a public nature. There must be a boldness about you. Are you just a Christian on Sundays? Because Sunday is the most segregated day there is. Because we lock in with only the people that we like. But Monday through Saturday, we are something else. Who knows that you are a Christian? Because there must be a public nature and display of your faith. There must be. Then there is the Savior's response. Jesus never replied to the thief on the left. I want you to know that. The thief on the left was asking for temporary, physical salvation. But Jesus was dying on the cross for an eternal and spiritual salvation. Jesus was on the cross to pay for our sins, the sins of humanity. Jesus was on the cross to open up the way to heaven. And as Jesus hung on the cross, He breathed his last. And the veil of the temple, symbolizing the divide between God and humanity, was torn from top to bottom. And the tearing of the veil did not occur from bottom to top, as if humanity could, through its own effort, bridge the gap between God and man. Instead, it tore from top to bottom, symbolizing a divine act that cleared the way for humanity to approach God. This act, a divine intervention, signifying the removal of the partition between God and man, achieved through Jesus' sacrificial death. Whew. The tearing of the veil did not occur from bottom to top, as if humanity could, through its own efforts, bridge the gap to God. We couldn't bridge the gap to God. Instead, it tore from top to bottom, symbolizing a divine act that cleared the way for humanity to approach God. Oh my God. This act, a divine intervention, signified the removal of the partition between God and man, achieved through Jesus' sacrificial death. And the thief to the left of Jesus failed to grasp this truth, and he consequently missed the opportunity for heavenly blessing, despite being in close proximity to Jesus. Close, but yet so far. Close, but yet so far. And some of you listening today, you're on the verge of forgiveness and salvation and the promise of heaven, but you're distant. You are distant. Why? Because you lack faith and courage to embrace Jesus. You lack faith. You don't want to go against the status quo. You want to stay with the majority. You want to live it up. You want to live in the moment. You want the blessing, but you don't want the blesser. You want the healing, but you don't want the healer. You want the, you know, the latter rain, but you don't want Jehovah Jireh. You gotta want all of him. You gotta want all of him. There is no taking a little piece here and leaving what I don't want. Just like the thief on the left, he wanted to be relieved of the torment, but he didn't want the one that could relieve it. You gotta want all of him. And the thief on the left implored Jesus to come down from the cross. And best believe Jesus had the power to fulfill it, because he could have summoned legions of angels to rescue him from the cross. But Jesus came on an assignment to save those that are lost. He came to save us, not just from a temporal situation, but to redeem us from an eternity of sin. So Jesus had to decide to answer the request of one thief or the other. One appeal was for temporary, earthly, selfish answers. And the other request was for eternal, spiritual, selfless answer. That's our God this morning. Are you like the thief on the left or the thief on the right? Where do you fall today? Where do you fall? Because there's a promise from Christ. There's a promise from Jesus. When Jesus declared, I tell you the truth. And in King James, it says, verily I say unto you. That's a solemn promise. Because Jesus was fulfilling the will of the Father, unwavering in his commitments to redemptive, for the redemptive plan. His resolve was unshakable. No pain was too severe. No sin too grave. No suffering too immense for him to bear on behalf of humanity. Jesus willingly endured the agony of the cross because he prioritized the eternal need for salvation over temporary concerns. His response to the thief's plea affirmed his unwavering commitment to the salvation and redemption of sinners. Our Lord has already affirmed it's yes and amen to your redemption. It's yes and amen to your redemption. It's yes and amen. So someone today may assume that you can wait till the very last hour to make your decision. But I'm here to tell you that Jesus has his arms outstretched. And he's saying, come unto me. I want to remind you that there were two thieves that day. There was one thief saved, but there was also a dying thief who refused Jesus that day. And he went into eternity with no hope and no salvation. His heart was hard and he found no peace or forgiveness. There were two thieves that made a decision that day. One accepted salvation and the other did not. One was saved in his last moments, which demonstrated that none of us should be lost, because even in that last moment, none of us know the hour, nor the minute, nor the second when we will depart. None of us knows. And today the Lord is saying, come. I did it all on Calvary just for you. So come unto me. My arms are outstretched. I want you to know that you're not alone today, as Jesus is near. He's here for you, and you can trust him. He's here to save you. He's here to redeem you. He's here to pardon you. He's here to forgive you. All you have to do is open up your heart and receive him now. Into my heart, into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come into my heart. Lord Jesus, come in to stay. Come in, I pray. Come into my heart. Lord Jesus. I know you have been through some stuff. You've been hurt on so many sides. But this is a defining moment where I know that our Lord can wipe away every tear from your eyes. It's not found in a bottle. It's not found on the street. But the comfort that he delivers is like no other. Come and drink of this water that will never run dry. You will thirst no more. Come to the Lord today. You're at the end of your rope, where you see no hope, no future. But I tell you today that if you accept the Lord as your personal Savior, your life will never be the same. He will turn a mess into a message. He's the illuminator, so the dark clouds will roll away. What I do know is that he takes responsibility. If you say, Lord, here I come, he will take you by the hand and lead you all the way. That's one thing I'm sure of. I'm a living, breathing, walking miracle. Where would I be if Jesus didn't love me? I have no idea. Would never want to experience the I don't know. But my life has been transformed and renewed because of him. Because I dare to believe. I dare to trust a loving Savior. And I know your life can be transformed and renewed. It's not too late. There's a postponement of judgment just for you. I said postponement, not elimination. Postponement of judgment just for you. Because the Lord is giving you an opportunity to hear and to respond. Now pray today that you heard and you will respond to the Lord tugging at your hearts. Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Won't you accept him today? Let this be the best Easter season that you experience in life. Let this be the day. You're not like the thief on the left, but you're like the thief on the right. Where the light was illuminated in your heart, and you believed in the Savior. Father, I just want to thank you today for your word. I want to thank you for your outpouring, Lord. I want to thank you for your mercy and your grace. I thank you for your unconditional love, Lord. And as your children listen to your words, your impartation, Lord, I pray that their hearts will be reminded of your love and the sacrifice that you made I pray, Almighty God, today that hearts will be mended. Hearts will be transformed and renewed for your glory. I pray, Almighty God, today that hearts will be reconciled back unto you, Lord. I pray for those that are wavering, that they will waver no more. I pray those that are weak and are limping by, Lord God, will be strengthened. I pray for those that don't know you as Lord and Savior will come into the knowledge and understanding of who you are and what you did on that day. Because you could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world, but you stayed on that cross so that we might live, so that we can have an opportunity to be reconciled back to the Father. I thank you for being the sacrificial lamb. I thank you for the unconditional love that you keep on extending to us. I thank you for the words that have been released. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And truly, truly, I say unto you today, you will be with me in paradise. I thank you for the words uttered, O God. And your words will continue to pursue us, Lord God, until our hearts yield before you. So, Father, today, I pray that the far and the reach is where this recording might land, oh God, that it will touch the heart of men. And you will enter into that soil, that open soil that will bear much fruit because of your word. Father, I thank you for your love. I thank you for being my God. My God, my Abba Father. I thank you. I thank you. I give you all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. This is Pastor Carleen Hepburn. I just want to thank you for being a part of today's session. I thank you for hearing God's word, and I pray that your life will be transformed and be renewed through this word today, and your life will never be the same. God bless you, and I pray that this holy week that we're setting into, that you will find him, you will pursue him, and you will find him. There is a response. There's a request and there is a response. What will your request be? What will it be? Because there's truly a response and the Lord is waiting to respond to you. God bless you and have an amazing week. God bless you.